When I see a blank canvas, I see so many things, so many forms, you know. Of course, only when I start painting, you know, then the forms get crystallized. Some of them they go off, some of them they stay on. But then I think of the entire canvas. I don't think of one particular space. When you see a blank canvas, I always feel that the canvas has to be layered, textured. You know, it's a process, and I cannot paint on a even professional canvas straight away, because my technique demands certain building up layers of pigments. So I use white pigments, 2-3 layers I give, and then afterwards I work with the textures, with acrylic paints, and I build up textures. And while I'm building up textures, it's almost like painting white on white. Already the painting looks ready. I mean, it could be framed and sent for a show. But then what I do is I keep it in the studio for a little time. Then when it's completely dry, it becomes completely hard, you know, and then I start using colors. So it's almost like you have painted twice on the same canvas. This house come studio was built 12 years ago, and one needed a place also in the city, you know. And also the architect was very particular about the light, particularly north, you know, south light. And so he planned this studio to get light throughout the day. You know, you can just move my easel anywhere because these four huge windows throws beautiful light. Even the walls are kept grey without painting. It has got a lot of lovely empty spaces. It's much more cozy a place. The advantage of my staying here in the same house is that, you know, I can just walk up to the studio in 2 minutes and I can start my work.
Vasu? Vasu?
Yeah?
Marie on the phone for you. Marie.
I got it.
I don't know whether you call it memories, because I'm at home. I don't feel that I've gone out of this place. 22 years of staying has made a lot of difference, and that sort of a thing doesn't go from one's mind. Bangalore, I have two places I work, my farmhouse as well as my city studio. And sometimes I come here and straight away go to the canvas. I have no problem. And again, go back to Bangalore and start painting. Because I consider that all these three spaces are connected, interconnected. Things have changed a lot here since the last 15 years. But fortunately, the place where I live, in Cholamandal, that place is still very nice and calm and spacious, and the same trees which have spoken to me years, they still speak to me. Being the only son between my two sisters, my parents thought that I would become either an engineer or a lawyer or a doctor, if not anything else, as an agriculturist. My father was an agriculturist. But my marks, I was always 45-50% chap. So it was impossible. After the intermediate, I thought perhaps I could go to art. But then, you know, my parents were told that let him do BSc, Physics, Chemistry, Mathematics. And I used to get a tuition for all the subjects, and that was a torture. Then I started doing caricatures of these cricketers and then musicians whom I admired. I was doing all these things without my parents' knowledge. You know, my cartoon and caricature for all these magazines was only after 10:30, 11 o'clock in the night. Then there was one art critic called G. Vengatachalam, and it is he who saw my work. Then he said, I think you should go to an art school. And there is KCS Panikkar, is very wonderful teacher, and Madras is very close by, you must go to an art school. I said, sir, how do I convince my parents? He said, I will talk to them. So my parents finally agreed, because they knew I was not happy at all. Then I went to a Madras art school in 1960. I was 18 and odd at that time. Then I gave Panikkar this letter, Vengatachalam's letter. He said, good, but I won't take you in unless you pass the test. I said, yes, sir. Test was something like drawing from the model, which I had never done. Somehow I managed, you know. I managed that, and I managed going and doing landscape outside, and I got a first rank, and then I was admitted to the college. But one thing my father felt, how are you going to make money from art? So initially, my father said, look, I will give you some money every month for your basic necessities. But that was not sufficient. Really, it's not sufficient, because I had to buy my colors, my canvas, my paper. It's all expensive. But in 1964, I applied for the National Scholarship, Government of India Cultural Culture Department Scholarship. And I got that scholarship that year, which was 250 rupees a month at that time. That was really a good sum. And so I told my father, please don't send any money anymore. I can manage. And I didn't touch my father's pie after that. And 1967, I got the National Award for my painting of Lalit Kala Academy. And so that really made my mother feel great. She said that, you know, that something, you know, her son has achieved. I mean, that feeling, you know, I could see that sort of a happiness in them. And so no going back after that.
Establishment of Cholamandal started because, you know, they requires an identity for the group of artists.
Not only did they paint, there was a whole sense of community there, you know, because they were planning Cholamandal.
Madras at that time, if you said you are an artist, you know, people will ask, and then, which means what do you do to survive?
There was the old romantic idea of having an isolated place for dreaming in art, and that also is Cholamandal, the locale of Cholamandal also suited that.
Cholamandal has always been a sort of, it's often been called a laboratory for artistic impulses and experiments.
When we started Cholamandal, it's like people coming and seeing, it's almost like a zoo, you know, for people coming and seeing artists.
We were all talking about artists colony or artists campus and things like that, but we never managed it. So that was absolutely fantastic that he managed to bring them all together, and it actually happened.
1965, in the College of Art, when we were studying, and Panikkar asked some of us what we would do after finishing the diploma. We didn't know what to answer, you know, I mean, how to answer that question. Then he said, look, some of my very good students, they have gone to commercial industry and they have lost themselves. And you know, I feel very bad about it. I know how difficult it is for an artist to survive.
Panikkar felt the need that unless there is a place and an alternative source of income which would keep the hearth burning and also allow the creative expression to flourish, that he thought of this kind of a place, you know, where they can work freely and earn through craft.
There was an American artist who had come to visit our college, and he was wearing a shirt which was designed by him. The first time we saw an artist design his own shirt, that's how we started doing batik. We were about 25-30 of us. We started learning batik and did the batik, and in 1 year we had produced enough, like saris, dress materials and wall hangings and so many things. We had an exhibition and it was a sellout in Chennai. That gave us the idea that we need a place, and it's possible for us to, even if one spent about an hour or two a day, we could make enough money for our basic livelihood. So we formed a cooperative, Artists Handicrafts Association we called it, and bought 10 acres of land in different stages and named it Cholamandal Artists Village. Started Cholamandal in 1964-65, most of us were, you know, in our early 20s or mid-20s. That's a fantastic age, you know, and an energy level is very high. That youth experiment things, not only in your art, but even otherwise in life, you know. So you're doing those things, and bong sessions or going to the beach and playing volleyball every day evening. We also tried to be together. It is not only for art you are here,
or to make living we were here, but we also wanted to share our joys and of life.
To actually be with people who discussed painting, who discussed color, who discussed texture, and to see a canvas and to see something take shape. This was a completely new experience, a new dimension to my life. And the advantage with being with Vasudev at that time is that he was surrounded by the whole young Madras crowd.
Vasu had a tremendous need to connect to filmmakers, to writers, to poets, to photographers, to media people, to art lovers. I mean, he didn't have a hierarchy in that. He just saw that as one contiguous field.
It was not simply art, you know, because there used to be dances happening here, there used to be dramas which used to be staged here in that open air theatre. And it brought a whole lot of, you know, creative minded people together.
Bala Saraswati dancing there with the lights went off, and she said, don't worry, ask somebody to switch on those headlights of those cars parked right around. And she danced by that.
The 60s meant that India had been independent for 20 years, two generations had just passed. We were the first generation that was coming of age when India became independent. So, and the question was bothering us as to what was Indian identity in the arts.
On one side, artists and writers want to a certain extent insist on their kind of a rootedness in the soil. On another side, they knew that rootedness doesn't mean following the same old roots that your previous people run. You have to live in your times and probably respond to the times. And that would mean that you are going to be contemporary whether you like it or no.
What seemed to be happening in Cholamandal looked to me what those days I used to call a kind of a return to nativity. And this nativist kind of, very deliberate nativist line that Panikkar had suggested to, in one sense, combat the growing influence of what he saw as Western art.
If you're looking at the Tamil Nadu scenario, first is lack of critics, lack of appreciation from the public. The public never understood what the Madras artists were doing. They did not know what was modern, what Panikkar was doing or what the others were doing. Nobody to, you know, really put it forth and explain all that. And Madras is a stronghold of dance and music. And art was never ever projected.
Critics in Bombay and, you know, in the rest of the country have tended to see them as craftsmen or craftspeople. And I've never seen that as something derogatory at all. Because I think the whole point of the Cholamandal school is they have a very, very good base in craftsmanship, and that's always a good thing.
Sometimes it also exerts a certain kind of pressure in their thinking too, making their art become too arty, or the craft become too crafty, or interact with each other.
That time there was no holy divide between art and craft. As an artist, you are a producer. You produce with your hands whatever seems of interest. Okay, at one point in Britain itself, the debate grew with William Morris, etc., on the difference between work of utility and a work of aesthetic.
Many people in the public, they thought that craft part of it is related to working with the hand. The other thing is should be working with the head.
Art, nobody was called artist. Artisan was probably closer to it. Even Michelangelo was not called an artist, he was an artisan. and he had a guild and he had other apprentices with him.
I work in ink on paper, oil on canvas, copper reliefs. Then I work with a weaver collaboration to do tapestries in silk. Then I have collaborated with ceramics, doing some work on ceramics, and then also with wood inlay artists. When I work in other mediums, for example, I also work in copper, metal reliefs. There, I got to plan everything. I cannot really change anything. For example, I take a copper sheet, fix it to a bed of lacquer, and then I plan the whole drawing and where exactly the, you know, sort of a depth should appear, and then textures, everything. Everything is planned. While beating the copper, I can't go out here or there. I got to plan it out very carefully. Whereas in painting, it's not like that. You can always play in different areas. When I was in Paris to learn the technique of stained glass, I wanted to go and see where Marc Chagall's stained glass are made. So I went to this studio and I found that Marc Chagall had done a painting, watercolor. It was on the floor. And this man, this craftsman, who is specialist in doing stained glass, he was working on that. And so I asked him, you know, how do you work on? He said, Chagall comes and leaves the painting. Now, I choose the glasses, the color, and I tell the manufacturers of glass to make these color glasses. And then I put them all together. Then temporarily I keep it against the light. And Chagall comes, stays in my studio for 2-3 days, corrects the things. That's it. And I do the work. So Chagall doesn't touch the glass. So I asked him, how many years you have worked with him? 40 years, he said. So that is collaboration. Everybody talks about Marc Chagall's, you know, huge pieces, but Chagall has not done anything in his hand, by his hand. It's all done by this craftsman. So it's a very, so that gave me sort of, a, you know, strength to say, yes, I work with a craftsman. Why not? And our Indian craftsmen are so good. They're really fantastic.
Thank you. when we thought of building a theater, the next thing that came to us was, hey, we need a logo. What is this theater going to look like in the logo? And of course, the building was not yet ready. So even to create a proposal and give it to people, you needed to say Ranga Shankara in a particular way. And I asked Vasu to design a logo for us. He's such a spontaneous giver, I would say, that he didn't even think twice. He said, Yenama, what do you want? I said, Vasu, I need a logo, something neutral, something that is theater. And he just drew out some 10 different doodles and sent them to me on little chits of paper with sketch pen and said, tell me which one you like and then I'll work on it. I mean, it was not like such a famous painter saying, okay, this is the logo as I see it, take it or leave it. The logo that we selected, it's at this magical point where you can't say there's a curtain and there are heads. And you don't know whether the heads are actors or whether they are the audience. It's at that magical point.
I met Arnavas when she joined the College of Art in 1962. She was 2 years junior to me in the college. Even Panikkar, a teacher, must have realized that we are good friends. So he encouraged us to become more closer. Many things I really liked in her. The strongest point is that she was a very strong woman. I always like to be in the middle of strong women. My mother was one, and Arnavas was another. And for me, I was completely strange to that community. I didn't know about the Parsis.
Well, he was from a very, very austere, I would say, Karnataka Brahmin background, if one has to talk about these things. And though he never himself displayed any signs of it, it was there in everything he did. And Arnavas had a way of recognizing this and laughing at it. And the sheer sort of earthy sensuality, that the life-giving quality of the Parsis was there very much in her.
All along, the problem was that whether we could get married at all because of our different backgrounds. Her family, you know, her family was not for it and my family was not for it. But in any case, you know, she told them that such and such a date, we're going to have registration done and... Then mother came, sisters came, they all came for registration and then sort of a wedding we had here. And at the same time, you know, I also had enough time to complete my cottage in Cholamandal. So she took a lot of interest in getting the whole thing done and our life began there. For me, I needed somebody to talk about my work regularly. I mean, some sort of a feedback, and she was the person to give me feedback. Because she also wanted my feedback to her works, and I really depended on her a lot, because it was not just as a wife she would appreciate whatever I did. No, certainly not. She would tell me point blank.
It was a really wonderful time for us, for Cholamandal, for artists, because I think Vasudev himself was coming into his own as a very, very significant artist of the south of the country itself. And Arnavas was in a very happy state of her life, because she just had this young boy, Barani. And it was altogether a very magical time for them which they were very happy to share with all kinds of people.
She was very happy to have a son, and she, but unfortunately, 3 years after our son was born, she found that she had cancer. Nearly 4.5 years she had on and off, you know, sort of a first surgery helped her nearly about 2-3 months. Then after 3.5 years, she got it once again, and then she, for about a year she lived, and then she died when she was 45. And our son was 7 years old. And for me, I faced everything, you know, that the last few years of her life. And I only feel sad that, you know, that she was such a wonderful, gifted, very good artist. If she had lived, she would have really done wonderful things. Well, prodigal son, you know, I left my father and went away in 1960. I never thought I would come back to be in the farm. Anyway, circumstances made me come back. And it was after I met Amu, you know, she's my wife now. After I met her, and I brought her here one day to show this place, and she said, it's such a beautiful place. Unless you build something here, you will not feel like coming and staying. Ponappa, who designed my Cholamandal cottage in 1971, when he was a student, he said that he would like to design this. So both Amu and I, we told him that we would like to have a courtyard house, you know. So based on courtyard, he designed the whole house. And Amu, she is very much responsible in building this place. As much as Arnavas was responsible in building Cholamandal cottage, Amu is responsible for this house.
It looks really pretty, no?
Very nice. This is really nice.
Yeah. No? So we can take this.
Yeah.
Astana must be having...
they take a lot of shots.
Yeah, we haven't got their pictures.
Yeah.
We were both older when we met, and we were both sort of established and fairly sure of ourselves as persons and individuals. And I think as, you know, if you're young and not very sure of yourself, you might find yourself being a little defensive or, you know, threatened by a person in the past who was such a, you know, sort of vital sort of person. But I think, you know, the stage at our, in our lives that we met and got together, I think played a role in the comfort zone.
It's amazing, all those who knew both of them. One was, they were both straight. They're very honest. They're very, you know, they're unhypocritical. They say what they like, and they are, you know, they have very strong notions. They're not this sort of, I'll follow the man around kind. They're clean thoughts. It's amazingly, sometimes when Amu says something, I think of Arnavas, not because Arnavas would have said it, but that independence of spirit and that forthrightness. I think that's what appealed to, or that's what something must have appealed to Vasudev. I always say that one marries one's mother, and it, you know, ultimately one's looking for prototypes of mother all around.
I said, like, being twice born, you're twice fortunate. You had these two wonderful women in your life.
Sadhana,
Vasu, as an artist, I think right from the beginning had come through as one of the outstanding artists among that group, and had a certain, let's say, marketability even at that time.
He did not confine himself to taking an artistic vocabulary from the cultural, from the art forms that were there, like, you know, tribal art or the folk art, which, you know, many other artists did. He derived his inspiration from literary sources.
His painting emerges from the richness of Kannada culture. So it is somewhere rooted, but not just rooted, it is also thrown open into the whole world.
He's a kind of a traditionalist in a way, with a lot of, let's say, contemporary subjects, contemporary ideas, contemporary ways of looking at things, but yet very Indian altogether.
There has been a great consistency in what he has been doing. There is, of course, a great commitment, and the fact that he has also done work in different medium, you know, he's been experimenting with a lot of different techniques and so on. And yet, underlying all of that, you can recognize a Vasudev.
The way he was working, he allowed things to come in its own way. The way he used colors, the way he used textures was so natural to him.
There is no difference between the way Vasu works with his themes and we writers work with our themes. He has a poetic vision.
Artist in the way, you know, he evolves his subject, the way he works at it, and he's a thinking artist, very much a thinking artist, very, very intelligent in, you know, to incorporate what is there in his experiences and bring it, you know, alive on his canvases.
Vasudev's work particularly was exciting because his was the most sensuous of, he was a very sensuous painter. Extraordinarily plastic, the colors were modulating, you know, and his painting seemed to emerge from a corner of the canvas and flow outwards. You know, his figures had a, whether they were leaves or whether they were fish or human beings, it didn't matter what. But they had a kind of amoeba-like quality, you know, a kind of ability to spread and become something alive, which was absolutely marvelous.
The work of Vasu, particularly the face since he moved to Bangalore, I think represents a very, very systematic departure from what he was doing. Not from his basic language, which more or less remained the same, his basic symbology remained the same, but the subtle shifts that happened in the way he articulated his own change and his own difference his own encounter, for example, with new social realities. It was no longer the artist locked away in an isolated chamber, but an artist who had stepped out into the world.
After moving to Bangalore, something else started happening in my work, reacting to things just happening around me. I was looking outside, you know. Earlier in my paintings, I was looking inside mainly. But now, both in Theatre of Life as well as in Artscape, I started looking outside.
This was beginning to speak in his canvases in a manner that would be visible only to someone who's been following it. It wasn't shouting out. It wasn't a flag-waving exercise. It wasn't saying that, look how I changed. None of that. It wasn't self-conscious at all.
When so many artists of his period of his age are trying to remain in that or to be in that rat race and doing something that which is not out of their own inner experience or own anubhuti, as one say, so their work looks rather very superficial. While in Vasudev's work, I feel they have that content of that emotional quality, something that is born out of anubhuti, their inner experience.
I realize how difficult it is for an artist who has reached a certain peak after, say, 30 years of work in one particular manner to want to change, you know, because you're so comfortable. You're getting all the accolades, you're financially comfortably off, you're being treated as a elder statesman or whatever, and there is no compulsion to get out of that comfort zone normally, and to want to do that, to try this, you know, to step out into new waters and test those waters, is a very bold and a courageous thing to do.
On the one hand, you know, as he comes across to everyone and including myself, he's a very gentle person, but at the same time very secure in who he is and very mature in his you know, the way he deals with the world. And so, and similarly, he seems mild, especially compared to me, but I think he has very firm opinions and strong convictions.
The other thing about Vasu is he's very, very open, very receptive to any kind of critical discourse. His face will fade if you say one negative thing about his work, but soon he'll recover and he'll think about it and say, yeah, I think what you're saying is interesting and important, let's, you know, continue the discussion. So in that sense, the ability not to personalize or take criticism personally, I think, is a very special gift the man has.
For a community, it is important that we have artists like Vasudev, because he not only does things in a very, very smooth way, and he makes sure that it the logical end is met. Like, you know, this Manikvelu mansion, the NGMA, I don't think it would have happened in Bangalore but for Mr. Vasudev. He made so much effort and he met Chief Minister and so many times. Finally, that Manikvelu mansion, he made sure that Karnataka Culture Department took that building on lease and gave it to Government of India to start a National Gallery of Modern Art.
The great thing about Vasudev is the amount of time he has spent with the younger generation, working with them, painting with them, guiding them, holding exhibitions, working with the Lalit Kala Academy, with the National Gallery. I think that is enormous work. I envy him there mainly because I have done nothing of that kind in my own field.
When I became a registrar of Bangalore University somewhere in 1996, few months after that, I saw Vasu taking an appointment from me. He came and there was only one thing in his agenda. He wanted to have an art school, preferably run by university. Promptly within a week, he brought the proposal. I was surprised. Vasu, you know, he was too busy as an artist, you know. I never expected that he would make that. I presented it, but somehow it was very difficult to sell because the traditionalist in the university had a stronghold. Could you believe that in the syndicate, one member tells me, visual arts, no, don't bring. They will spoil the students. Libertine. They drink, they go out. All of my registrar time, it did not take much other headway other than presenting it, but nothing coming out of that. Forgotten, I thought Vasu also has forgotten. Then after a gap of 1 or 2 years, I became a vice chancellor. One of the earliest call is Vasu again. He said, look, can you do it now? Yes. Forever, Bangalore University should be grateful to this man. Yes, you Vasu there.
In 1988, Arnavas died, and some of my friends suggested that since there are not much of art foundations, it could help if you start a foundation and help the younger generation of artists, students and others, you know. Since we also had gone through that stage, both Arnavas and I, we had gone through that stage earlier. Then I thought of that, and then we formed a trust. So I called it Arnavas Vasudev Charities, and so it is going on since 1989. We have been giving financial assistance to young artists, out of which at least 25 to 30 of them, they have made names. They have made name in the country. So they are planning to have an exhibition, and in case if anything sold in those exhibitions, part of it can go to the charities. The idea is to make this foundation one of the largest ones in South India.
Down.
I don't see that I'm an artist only creating something on my canvas. You know, I'm for me, I don't differentiate much between art and life. It is, it's otherwise, you know, it's not a sort of a thing which I take it only as a profession, working certain hours. For me, it's a part of my life.
I mean, I'm sure there are.
I can't go out. There's only 8 to 6. You just want to be there.
Secret houses where you can go
out. He has never committed anywhere. Very diplomatic. But here, the diplomacy didn't work. But I want to know. I want to know who gets the book. Done perhaps about 7 or 8 series. Starts with fantasy, Maithuna, Tree of Life and Death, Humanscapes, He and She, Earthscapes, Theatre of Life, and now it's Rhapsody. So now, if I see them all one by one, I feel that there is a certain continuity, a line which goes through in all these things. Arrival, yes, today you have arrived at certain things because you have done something, you get satisfaction. But then again tomorrow morning, you see the painting, you'll start thinking of doing something else. If you don't have that sort of a thing, that means you are dead. I think an artist's process has to be continuous.